the same state where my father was born, Pennsylvania, we have a young man who is brave enough to confront you face to face, eye to eye. We ask you to give him some encouragement. The future pastor, Drew Tilley.
Joke right now, Moving forward, when I was 7 years old, I got my first real glove, so I have leather now. First real glove, my first real ball, and my first real bat. This time my dad started taking me to actual baseball fields to practice with me. He'd throw me pitches after pitches after pitches, and my hit, my hit, my hit. Then sometimes he would work on me, he would work with me on my fielding as well. So I'd take ground balls, fly balls, all that. Now one of the things to help me with my fielding was actually in our backyard, we would play a game together. The game was you throw ground balls at each other, so I'd throw them at him, which sometimes was actually fun, because I got to throw stuff at my dad. And then he'd throw things at me, or throw the ball at me, and we'd have to field it. The purpose of the game was if you fielded it cleanly, you got 0 points. If you touched the ball but you didn't field it, 1 point. If you missed it completely, 2 points. The loser was the person that would get to the highest amount of points. So if we were playing to like 21, if you got the 21, you obviously lost. So you keep track. Now, to understand this, and the hard part about this, my backyard was treacherous. I mean, you're talking no landscaping, no greenskeeping at all. Bumps, holes, roots, all that. So the ball is going to be bouncing around. And this would actually help me in high school because I played third base, and as Dan, wherever he's at, could attest, our field was just absolutely treacherous out of high school. So it was helpful. Now, the next year when I was 8 years old, I began playing organized baseball. When I was playing organized baseball, the one thing that was really kind of cool for me was I was so far ahead of the other first year players because they didn't necessarily practice or work at baseball for years and years and years before. It was my dad training with me and practicing with me and just teaching me about the game that kind of put me above where they are. And ultimately, I would say that's why I'm able to play baseball at college right now. What am I getting at? This is a lot like the Christian life. In the Christian life, we reach out to people, and sometimes they accept the Lord, and other times they might accept the Lord, but they kind of go on their way. But a lot of times they lose their way. New believers often accept the Lord, and then it's like they'll be good for a little while, they'll have the joy of the Lord for a little while, and then all of a sudden, they hit a rut, they hit life. Life hits it. They don't know what to do. They don't know where to go. For example, we have BBS. All these kids, some kids accepted Christ this week. And that's awesome. But they need to know where they're going, how to do things. So this morning I'm going to talk about discipleship. Because I think it's something that, honestly, as Christians, we kind of lack on. Just mentoring younger Christians or just newer Christians. So, the passage we're going to be looking at this morning is in 2 Timothy. So, if you could turn your Bibles there to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 10. And we're actually going to go into chapter 4, verse 5. I'm not sure if everyone's Bible will be the same, but in mine it's listed as Paul's charge to Timothy. Just a quick background on Paul and Timothy. If you don't know, Paul and Timothy, their relationship is probably the most personal example we see in Scripture of a discipleship. I mean, we have Christ and his 12 disciples, but Timothy and Paul, they were always with each other, always out on missions, and Paul considered him almost like, or considered him a son. One thing that if you notice on your bulletins, there's a little outline. You can kind of fill it out. We're going to go look at two things here. First, I'm going to read through the passage, and then we're going to go through and we're going to look at the aspects of a mentor and disciple that we get from this passage. away from the truth and turn aside to myths. But you, keep your head in all situations, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, and discharge all your duties of your ministry. The first thing we're going to look at here is the mentor obviously. Paul would be the example. In verses 10 through 13, we see that a mentor needs to be an example setter. That'll actually be your first thing to fill in. An example setter. Here, Paul gives the testimony of his life. He reminds Timothy of the things that Timothy would know about because he served with Paul for a while, but also just the different things that were known about Paul and the things that he went through. He's reminding him that I've been through this. With that, he also is giving him a warning, though, here in verses 12 and 13. He says, in fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. The point that he's making is, you know what? I'm a follower of Christ. That's why I'm going through this. If you follow Christ, you're going to have to go through trials and things like that, struggles. Not necessarily from other people, but maybe in the spiritual sense as well. The thing that after that is he gives you the reality of the world. Evil men and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. People will come and you might actually start to believe them. They might not have their beliefs right. They might not even be Christian. But for whatever reason, you hear them and it just clicks. And you get deceived. But those men are also deceived. And things are just going to get worse and worse and worse. Paul was seeing this already at this time. However, the next thing that a mentor, in light of all this, needs to do or be is an encourager. That's the second one. In verses 14 through 17, Paul personally encourages Timothy. 14 and 15, those verses, is specifically to Timothy. As for you, continue on what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. What he's saying here is, and in chapter 1 of this book actually, Timothy grew up in a home with a Christian mother and a Christian grandmother that are spoken highly of by Paul. So he's been growing up in the church. So this is just an encouragement. Hey, keep on doing what you're doing. You know the truth. Stay with it. Keep working. It's a personal encouragement to him, saying, hey, you know it. You know, I didn't have to teach you all this. This is like born into you, more or less. The next part, though, is a general encouragement that is to Timothy, but is also to everyone in general. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. The point here is truth. He's giving the encouragement of this is the truth right here in the Word of God. And you can use it for anything you're going through in your life. The next thing would be, the next section is, a mentor needs to be a leader of a person in the relationship of a disciple and a mentor. Paul first says, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, he's basically making how serious his letter is. He's trying to tell them, look, tell Tim, this is serious. I really want to get this point across to you. As a leader, when you're pouring into someone's life, you need to be really serious and committed with the time that you spend with them. Now, I'm not saying you can't joke around, because those that I consider mentors in my life, we probably have some of the funnest times around. And so, like, it's a friendship, but at the same time, there needs to be a sincere intention there. That you still have to have that time where you're saying, leading a person more or less in the faith, trying to just, you know, guide them along. And that's kind of that's what Paul did, more or less. And here, he's just showing the importance that that of the words that he's trying to say. Preach the word. Timothy was the leader of the church at Ephesus, and he was preaching. He was still younger than most of the apostles. So he's just telling them, keep going. A leader needs to more or less kind of give a commissioning to someone. Now, not everyone here who's a believer is going to be a preacher, just like not everyone is called to missions. But in all of our lives, there is a calling. And within that calling, we need to be kingdom-minded. And that's kind of what Paul's saying here. And I'll get into that a little bit in the next section. Finally, a mentor needs to be a motivator as well. That's the last one, a motivator. In 3, 4, and 5 here, things kind of get grim again, but Paul's motivating Timothy. Why does Timothy need to listen to this command? For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Already Paul had been seeing in the church that things were starting to get a little hairy. One of the big things was Jewish men who thought they were Christians were going around and telling the Christians, who were Gentile Christians, that they had to be circumcised. Now, I don't know about you, but if I heard that was for my faith, I'd probably think twice about accepting Christ. I haven't experienced it because I was just a kid when it happened, but I just trust that it would be a huge deterrent for someone to go to their faith at that time. Now, the other thing going on is Paul knew his Jewish history. He was a leader in the Jewish faith. If you look back in the Old Testament, time after time, Israel would do this. God, you are our God. Okay, so let's get a golden calf and worship the calf. Oh, we're so sorry, God. We are so sorry. You are a God. Thank you. Thank you for saving us. All right, we're going to go marry people from other countries that we're told not to do by God. Okay, God, we're sorry. You get the point. They kept falling into rebellion. And this is the thing that Paul was already seeing with the Christian church. You're starting to see the wayward actions of them. So Paul knew what was going to happen. He knew that even though his life was near the end at the time that he was writing this, he was saying, Timothy, look, the wheels are in motion. There's going to be one group going downhill. You need to stay here and try and keep going here. So he gives that in 3 and 4. They will turn their ears away from truth to turn aside from this. The other thing here is Paul knew that conviction is really hard on people. I don't know about you, but I really don't like when someone tells me I did something wrong. So what people will do with their faith sometimes is if they hear a preacher not necessarily condemn things that they actually know in their hearts are wrong, but not necessarily condone it and just kind of look past it, they'll kind of be like, you know, I like this guy. He lets me do what I want, you know, in a sense. And Paul knew this. Paul saw this coming. He wasn't dumb. So this is one thing that he was trying to get across. So just like the Jewish Christians that still had a lot of pride within their Jewish faith, because that was some of what was going on at the time, his point was, they're going to want to hear about, and I don't mean to bring it up again, but the circumcision thing. Because that is a Jewish thing. Hey, we need to do this because, you know, that's our thing. And we got to make this faith kind of our faith too. So Paul knew that people had a selfish motivation in learning from the scripture. Now, we went through what a leader needs to be, a mentor needs to be. Now we look at his disciple. First thing I want to say, with a disciple is it doesn't have to always be a young person. In fact, I believe that everyone in this room needs to have a disciple or have a mentor of some sort. some sort of accountability. Because as Christians, we can't teach ourselves. The Holy Spirit is there to guide us. Yes, this is true. We do have the Word. But there's a reason why God created people, and we are vessels that He's using to guide us. So, with that in mind, we can all learn from the disciple thing section here. But this is also why we need to have disciples or be discipled. The first thing that a disciple needs, that we need, or that you need to do for a disciple, is be a good example. A must-have is a good example. That's the first section. As Christians, we all need one. Especially young believers. Especially those kids that this week would have accepted Christ. Especially the young man that was baptized this morning. He needs someone to continue to walk alongside him. Keep showing him the ropes. Just like my dad would have me in the backyard and he'd continue helping me with baseball. Here, Paul more or less gives a testimony of his life. I mean, and by testimony, I just mean not his whole life story, but he says, you know who I am. You know what I've been through. A disciple needs someone like that. We need, in our mentor, we need that to be someone who has been through life, has seen the trials, seen the battles. I'm thinking of my own mentors in my own life right now, and just how I can pull from encouragement from the fact that they've gone through their lives and made it. Here, Paul's saying to Timothy, look, I've been through literally hell and just the different things that he's faced. In fact, Timothy's from Lystra, and it's believed that the first time Paul was in Lystra, Timothy obviously saw the beatings that were going on. And yet, Timothy still chose to go out with him, which kind of boggles my mind. But, he's saying, I went through all this, but yet it was God. And that's the other thing. You have to have a firm faith. God got me through this. God rescued me from this. Also, honesty is a huge thing. As I was preparing this message, that was one thing that I felt God really put him on my heart. The honesty part. The Christian life cannot be sugar-coated. And if it is, often it's going to lead to destruction. My point here is, I've been to festivals, Christian music festivals, and I'm sure some people here may have been or have watched Billy Graham or something. And tons of people give their lives to Christ there. But like I was mentioning earlier, when things get tough, they just kind of give up. They're like, well, I thought my life was supposed to be perfect, happy. They're given this almost sugar-coated gospel of, hey, being Christian means life's going to be hunky-dory, perfect. And that's not the case. Now, I'm not saying that you need to go and say to them that your life's going to be terrible. I'm not saying that at all. But they need to know what they're getting into. And that's where you're being a good example is. You're being honest. You're saying, look, there's going to be tough times, but I got through my tough times, and you can get through your tough times. The other thing, when we see this in the passage where Paul, again, talks about his persecutions, and then he goes on to say, in fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Persecution doesn't necessarily mean another person to another person. It can also mean in the spiritual realm. We face temptations, battles with fear, things like that. We're going to face those kind of persecutions. And then the last thing I have here as well is know the reality of the world around you. That's from verse 13. While evil men and imposters will go from bad to worse. A mentor needs to tell a disciple, and a disciple needs to know, this is what's happening. It goes along with the honesty, really. But this is what happened. See what is going on in the church. Don't let yourself get caught up in these myths or lies. next thing, though, and again, just like Paul was, he gave the kind of ugly stuff, he went into an encouragement. For a disciple, the second thing is you must accept and be encouraged. Accept encouragement and be encouraged by whoever's mentoring you. Specifically, here, just as Paul talked to Timothy, when you're discipling a young person or another Christian, give them specific examples that they can draw on. Like, in the case of Ridge. Now, I don't know him personally, but Pastor Jack, you do. If he's ever in a tough time in his faith, say, Ridge, remember this. Remember how you did this, that. Remember that time you got baptized? You take their own lives and good things that are in their lives, and you said, hey, you can do this. You've done it before. You've done this or that. I know things are tough right now, but remember this. So you draw on their own lines to encourage them. And then, again, the general encouragement is, hey, I know things are rough for you, whoever the disciples are. I know things are rough for you, but God's word has something that you can get from it and learn how to deal with it. It might take you a little while to figure out what it is. You might have to really, really search the Bible, but know that there is truth in the Bible and that you can get your answers there or guidance. After that, there's the commissioning. That's the third one. This is in verses 1 and 2 again in chapter 4. The first thing I have is must come from an elder or a more mature Christian. Now, before I go into it, let me explain my commissioning. I'm not saying that every disciple, you need to say it, alright? You go preach. You go into missions. I'm not saying that at all. What I'm saying, though, is you're saying, live a godly life. That's the commission. At the very root, live a godly life that you're giving. They must come from an elder or a more mature Christian. As we see in verse 1 here, where Paul says, in the presence of God and Christ Jesus, Paul has an authority. He was working that much for God, that hard for God, that he had an authority. And he's really trying to show that authority, but also the importance of his message right here. Similarly, if you're being discipled, you need someone, again, who's been through the battles, but also is strong in their walk. Strong in their walk and mature in their faith to help guide you. Because with this, they have an authority over you. And again, it goes back to the guidance thing. The next part I have, it comes back to preach. Now, I didn't mention this the first time through, but under preach, in the Greek text for this passage, the word that is used in the Greek language, and I don't have it up here, plus I don't think anyone would remember it, but the word used is actually a word that was used for proclaim, the word proclaim. The word was also used to mean, at that time, the Roman Empire was big. The Rome, a messenger, more or less. So, the same word was used to describe a guy who worked for the emperor, and his job was just to walk through the cities and say, hey, this is what the emperor says. You know, please give me more money, something like that. So, it's just saying do your job, more or less. Proclaim the truth that you know, proclaim the message that you have. Here, I broke it down a little bit because, again, it's using your gifts in life. Now, I've heard people say, and this, they say, as a plumber, you know, I'm a plumber I'm a Christian, but I'm a plumber, so I need to plumb. I can't be always sharing my faith. I understand that, but you need to be looking for your opportunities to use your gifts. The point here is as a disciple, encourage them to use their gifts. If you're in high school and you play a sport and you're a believer, I'm not saying you have to walk up and be in, like, just talking right away about faith issues. But be sensitive to opportunities to bring it up. Keep that on your mind. That'll help you in more ways than one, both personally and also potentially for someone else's life. The other thing, be prepared. It goes with that. You need to be prepared. You need to be firm in your faith. Firm in your faith and to be able to stand there. Now, the last part is simply, you can fill this in. Why is there a need for discipleship? That's the last part here. We see this again in verses 3, 4, and, well, 5, ultimately, 2 of them. In verses 3 and 4, a time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, they will, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. I touched on this a little earlier. How many branches of Christian churches are we starting to see nowadays that have gotten away from doctrine because they didn't want to hear doctrine? I mean, in school we read a lot of books. Read just a lot of books that aren't textbooks, but books about just the Christian life. And in many of them, they almost talk about doctrine as if doctrine's a bad word. I believe Paul saw this coming as well. And he's telling Timothy this, but he's also telling us this. And the thing that we need to instill, and I don't have this in there, but we need to instill this in the young people. You need to have sound doctrine. You need to have it because it keeps you right with God and keeps your life on the right path. And I believe in America right now, that's just something that Christians are struggling with. There's Christians that are kind of going by the wayside because they want to hear what their itching ears want to hear. A lot of times they don't want to hear about the negative things, so they don't go to a pastor who preaches the word. They go to a church where the pastor, all he preaches is the happy-go-lucky stuff. This should not be. You need the Christian walk. There's the good, the bad, and the ugly. The beautiful part about it is God's grace in it all. So we need to instill in our young people sound doctrine, and that they need to be sure that they're not just listening to whatever sounds awesome to them or fun. They will turn their ears away from truth and turn aside to this. First thing that came to my mind, Tom Cruise in Scientology. It's a myth. It really is. I don't think I'm proclaiming anything new there. But Scientology, or even other branches of Christianity that have gotten away from doctrine and stuff, they're myths. And again, it goes back to hearing what you want to hear. Now, the point in all of this is, along with making sure that the young person or the person you're discipling needs to know truth, they need to know the reality again of the world they're in. They need to know that they're going to hear things that might sound good to them, but that might not be truth. A lot of people in my generation especially, and people I know, are getting caught up in different movements in the Christian church. And almost rebelling the faith itself, but saying it's within the Christian belief. And that follows this. We need to prepare our young people to know that there's going to be messages thrown at them that are covered or wrapped in a nice, hey, this is still Christianity, but inside a box, it's not. They need to know that they got to prepare for discernment. They need to know, though, also, that's going to be another persecution, actually. It's going to be a persecution in their life because they have lies kind of being thrown at them. So let them know the reality. Finally, in verse 5, it's more encouragement. And as I have written, encourage you, you need to encourage someone being discipled to stay the course in the hard times. Keep your head in all situations. I don't know about anyone else, but I tend to actually move on emotions more than the spirit. That's something I struggle with. So if my emotion's running high, I kind of follow where my emotions go. So if I'm in any situation, what I get out of this passage personally is you need to take a step back, stand firm, observe things, and make sure that it's something that is righteous or right with God. Another thing is, you know, I'm sure you can think of when you want to snap and just beat on someone that just annoys you. Parents, maybe you can learn this for your kids, I don't know. Endure, keep your head in all situations. And I'm not saying parents beat their children. I don't want to get accused of that. But the point is, you know, step back. Let things kind of go through. Literally, it's letting the Spirit work in you. Letting God's Spirit kind of say, hey, this is what's going on. This is the right way to react. Keep your head. Endure hardship. Same thing. Tough times are coming. I know personally there's been times where I've had a tough time, and even though I'm going to God, I'm not really going to God, and things are just rough, and I can't really get through it. But what he's saying is endure the hardship. If you stay right with God, you can get through this. So it goes back to, again, knowing the reality for the young person. Let them know that, yeah, you're going to face hard times, but endure. You know, stand firm in your faith. Endure. Do the work of an evangelist. This goes back to the evangelism point. You need to always be ready to preach. Preach, or at least speak of your faith. Sometimes you're not going to know when, but always do the work of an evangelist. An evangelist is always ready to speak. Sometimes you have to be bold. Sometimes it's just in the quietness of just a friend and another friend. And then discharge all the duties of your ministry. For me, this part of the passage that we can take for discipleship, but also in our own lives, points back to the Great Commission, which was read earlier. It says, go and make disciples of all nations. Discharging all the duties of your ministry. One of the things we're taught in ministry training as a whole is that, at least for youth ministry, is that we're to raise up student leaders within our youth group. Now you might be thinking, duh, isn't that the point? But, and an example of this would actually be this week with Dan. Dan's the senior, or is the youth pastor at First Christian Church. But Sean is his intern, and he discharges his duties to Sean because Sean needs the training of how to lead a mission trip. So Sean led the mission trip. Josh here, he's also an intern. He was discharged with the ministry, or the duty that was discharged from him was the work projects. So within this, and please know that this isn't just for the mission trip, this is actually how the youth group functions. Dan allows his student leaders to do different duties and run them. The point here is you kind of need to give your disciple, like kind of, if you're discipling someone, or give them some sort of responsibility that they can do. You know, it doesn't have to be a major thing, but just small things. Because you know what? Small thing, small thing, small thing, small thing, small thing, and eventually they get up here. They just keep building. Rather than let's do a big thing here, but they've never done the in-between stuff, so they have no idea how to do it. Discharge your duties. Through that training, they will then, the goal, and this is what Christ tells us, the goal is, okay, you've been training in your faith. Hey, now it's your turn to go and disciple someone. Now, obviously, the time and period of time that this takes, you know, who knows? It varies for everyone. But the point is, facing physical battles, but also spiritual battles. And just as we couldn't get to heaven on our own without God, he sent his son Jesus to die for us and to be an example for us too in the life that he lived. Just as we can't do that alone, we can't really go through life alone as Christians. We need other Christians to guide us. God's given us the Holy Spirit, and with the Holy Spirit as well, he's also charged us and commanded us to look out for each other, have each other's backs, guide each other, teach each other. It's not easy, but Christ does empower us. Timothy, because of God's calling and Paul's mentoring, became the leader of the early church. He was a leader in the early church. Now, I'm not saying that necessarily it wouldn't happen without Paul, but chances are that he potentially would not have been the man that he was without Paul's mentorship. Personally, without spending hours with my dad playing baseball, I could not say, hey, I play college baseball. I couldn't. It's all the way back to that time when I was young. Without a mentor in our lives as Christians, especially the young believers, we're playing with fire. Not just in their lives, but in our own lives too. Because we need mentors just as much as they need us. And not having that other Christian in your life to talk to, it can make things really difficult. So this morning, I'm going to close with this. And I know I'm young, but I'm going to kind of echo the sentiment of what this pastor just said. And I'm speaking to myself as well. And I believe Christ commands us to this. We all need, and consider this maybe a charge, I don't know. We all need to disciple someone. Those of us who are older, we need to be looking out for them. Now, you don't have to be best friends with someone. And you don't necessarily even have to constantly be in contact. But there needs to be some sort of guidance, you know, looking out for someone. We all need to seek that kind of thing in our lives. I feel like that's a duty that we're called to do as Christians. And I believe that's the way God designed us. And then lastly, if you're a young person in